Influence comes in various ways, at work and at home. All right, so influence is something that you cannot turn it off, you cannot turn it on. It's just there. It is either we are sending out the right influence or we are emitting the wrong influence. When you are tired, you are still influencing somebody, or something is still influencing you. And so what did we say? Growing in influence. This is what we call it. We say growing your influence. And we say influence is the capacity to have an effect on the character of something, someone, or be affected by something or someone, right? And either way, if you're a parent, you're a person of influence. If you're a brother or a sister to somebody, you're a person of influence. If you are a boss or an employee, you are an influence to somebody. Every human being on earth gives some form of influence. Now, what kind of influence is it? Let me bring it down home by saying, everyone that is born of a woman has a fragrance from your body that goes out. If you take a shower, the fragrance is fresh, am I right? If you maybe go to work out or sweat in the garden or do something, the fragrance from your body at that time is a bit different because all the salt and, you know, the body is excreting the waste out. So the fragrance is different. It is just so natural with influence. You know, it is either the influence is a pleasant, positive influence, or it is a negative influence. But either way, we are influencing someone, something, and someone or something is influencing us. Praise God. The whole ministry of Christ, when he was born, from the time he called his disciples together, all that he did, he did not send them to any Bible college. No, he didn't. He did not send them to any school. Or say, go and join that church and you'll be, no. He lived with them for 3.5 years and he influenced them to a point where when he left them, the effect of his influence on their lives made them world acclaimed people. The Bible says, stated, documented that they were the ones that revolutionized the world. And they say, who are these guys that ain't nothing seemed to stop them? They have become so unstoppable. Who are they? What did they study in the school? What is their family background? What are all kinds of questions? And we discover that when those people, these Pharisees and the Sadducees, asked those questions and they did their research, they discovered that, oh, they have been hanging out with Jesus. That was no wonder. They've been hanging out, so hanging out with Jesus influenced them to a point where they became world changers. Amen. Come on, amen.
Amen.
They became world changers. And it is our turn. They've turned the baton to us to continue, you know, exhibiting that influence, you know, so that we can turn our world upside down. Praise God. Amen. So influence actually is not just about between you and God, the result between you and God. Influence also determines the level of our financial success and material blessings. If you know what I mean. It affects everything in our lives. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Have you ever had a friend that you said, well, every time I go to that person, I feel drawn down, I feel pulled down, I don't feel encouraged. Have you somebody like that? And you have some other friends where you say, I like that person because every time I hang around that person, I feel pumped. You know what I'm saying? I get new ideas to do things.
Yeah.
So everyone has one certain kind of influence on you, the other person influence. But if somebody was to talk about you, what would they say? What would they say? That would somebody say, I like hanging around him or her because, or maybe I don't like, oh, he's coming again. Oh, tell him we're busy. Or tell them we're busy. You know why? Because whenever you go, everything gets shut down. Oh. Is that the kind of influence we send? We have got to be aware, just like the law of gravity, you cannot change it, you can only use it to your advantage. The same way influence is. And the scripture we have been using is this same scripture. And in fact, God has been opening this scripture to me personally in a way that I feel like I'm not even qualified to teach it yet or to share it with others yet, because I'm still learning it myself. I said to myself and I said to her, hey, the way I'm seeing this scripture, I don't know whether, I don't think I should, it's for me, it's more for me this morning, so please bear with me. These are the things that God has been teaching me and I'm learning. And we said, okay, we have got to put these things to use in our own lives first, you know, because there's no point teaching something that I'm not applying. Amen. It's just like you're serving food in a restaurant, but you've not tasted it. You know, we went out and we saw, Ali went out 2 weekends ago, and was it like 2 weekends ago, last weekend, I can't remember now. And Ali went and bought a pizza from, made by an Indian. So he said, you know, this pizza is made by an Indian, we wonder what it's going to taste like. You know, if they're going to buy good pizza, it has to be made by an Italian. You know, Italians know how to bake pizza, not an Indian, not an African, you know what I'm saying? Not the Chinese person making pizza. What is it going to taste like? But, you know, it turned out quite nicely. Tasted very good. So that means they did your homework well, if you know what I mean. Okay, so we see here, we said, if we were to read it together here, he said, let me tell you why you are here. You are here to be salt seasonings that bring out the God flavors of this earth. If you lose your saltiness, how will people taste godliness? You've lost your usefulness and will end up in garbage. Here's another way to put it. You are here to be light, bringing out the God colors in the world. God is not a secret to be kept. We are going public with this. As public as a city on a hill. If I make you light bearers, you don't think I'm going to hide you under the bucket, do you? I'm putting you on a light stand. Now that I've put you there on a hilltop, on a light stand, shine. Keep open house. Be generous with your lives. By opening up to others, you'll prompt people to open up with God, his generous Father in heaven. Can we pray for the sick? Just let me hold on right there. Can we pray for the sick?
Yes.
Heavenly Father, we give you thanks. Yes, Lord. You are our God who believes in our well-being.
Yes, Lord.
You believe in our dignity, and you've done everything to promote our dignity and well-being.
Yes,
Father, today we agree together according to your word. If two shall agree regarding anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them. Today we agree that everyone that needs healing among us, we receive healing for that person right now. We speak life to that person. We speak restoration. We speak strength. We speak perfect healing right now in Jesus' name. And anyone that we know that is ill, friends, colleagues, loved ones, neighbors, wherever they are, far and near.
Yes,
yeah, even family members. Yes. Father, we bring Joseph, yes, and Brother James,
yes,
and my sister's grandma,
yes,
wherever they are, and every other person that we may not know,
yes,
we bring them before you. Yes. And in the name of Jesus, we declare healing for them. We pronounce healing to them.
Yes.
We receive healing for them.
Yes.
We receive healing for each and every one of us, including our children,
yes,
in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God.
Thank you.
Okay, God wants his people to know him, so he has chosen you to be his special agent that will make him known. God wants his people to know him. God wants to be known. God wants to be known by his people. When I say to be known, I'm not talking about knowing of God. I'm talking about knowing God. I'm not talking about hearing about God. I'm talking about knowing God, experiencing God, experiential knowledge, not hearing about, if you know what I mean. Religion tells us about a God. Relationship, makes us to taste and feel and experience the God, the living God. Amen?
Amen.
The only living God. Amen. Religion tells stories about a God, depending on what that God, or the God of our religion, may be. Relationship with Christ brings us into a personal relationship, a personal experience with God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So God has chosen you to be an agent of Him, of His. Agent of His. You are an agent of God. Let me tell you something. You know, sometimes we say, okay, if you're a Christian and you want to serve God, you have got to abandon everything and pick up your Bible. Can I tell you something? No, you do not have to abandon everything. You can include the Bible, and you are advised to include the Bible. But let me say something. God did not call everybody to be a preacher or a missionary. Mm-hmm. God called you and equipped you with the idea for business and money making so you can reflect Him, because He's a God of prosperity. Amen?
Amen.
Come on, amen?
Amen.
God has given some people the idea to, you know, for academics. You know, when it comes to academics, they are very sound, and they can read, and they can argue and win arguments. Science, whatever sphere of education, this is because our God is a God of knowledge. Amen?
Amen.
He is the source of all knowledge, the source of all wisdom.
That's right.
How many of us know so many scientists that are Christians? Very top scientists, world-class, world-renowned Christians, scientists that are Christ believers. I was looking at a few books, you know, like in the field of physics, that I really enjoy physics, right? I like it. I don't like the maths in it, but I like it. But I was looking, I said, who are these top guys? What is their faith? Where do they stand? And I was amazed and actually excited to find out that there's so many of them that are Christians that are still alive today. And even back then, many of them believe in God. But look at the book of Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 5, if you don't mind.
Before I made you in your mother's womb,
thank you. I knew you.
Before you were born, I chose you for a special work.
Thank you. Just leave, even if we left it there, that is good enough. Before I made you in your mother's womb, God said about Jeremiah, I knew you. So you were somebody to me. And you were important to me to a point where I carefully mapped out a specific assignment for you. I know you. That's what God is saying. So in other words, the giftings that you have and your special interest, unique interest, they don't have to be like mine before they are acceptable before God. If you know what I mean. It's the wrong teaching that sometimes makes us feel like, oh, if you're going to serve God, you have to do it this way.
Yeah.
Or you have to do it that way.
Yeah.
You know, have you seen flowers in the spring? Have you seen insects? Have you seen birds? Have you seen the stars? Haven't you seen nature, trees, and animals? Each of them unique in its own way?
Mm-hmm.
See all the flowers thieving together, blooming together. Some are very tiny. Some are very large. Some move like the sunflower. They have a way to move. Some don't move. They just stand there still. But nobody compares itself. None of them compare with the other. They appreciate themselves the way they are. And they flower. And they bring out their leaves. They grow in their unique ways. But each of them expresses the glory and the beauty and the excellence of God. Amen.
Amen.
Come on, amen.
Amen.
Come on, amen.
Amen.
So the same way we human beings are made, everything that God has made, He made it in such a way that it will express an aspect of God. So you are built and designed to express an aspect of God. Amen.
Amen.
Come on, amen.
Amen.
With your uniqueness. And let me tell you something. The circumstances in which you were raised, they are not strange to God. They are actually allowed and permitted by God. Woo! Hallelujah. You see, vines don't grow in very fertile grounds. They don't prosper well. If you grow grapes, the vines, they prosper. Am I right? Am I correct? You know that.
All right. If you see, they prosper in a dry, more dry land, parched land, like places like California. If you know what I'm saying? That those kind of areas. But you, if you want to grow spinach, you've got to grow spinach and corn on that black, thick, rich soil. If not, it's not going to do well. If you're going to grow cucumber, you have to, you know, help the soil a little bit. If you know what I'm saying? But all the plants are designed by God, aren't they?
Amen.
Aren't they? Maybe in your life, you were raised in a rough place, or you have had rough experiences growing up. Maybe you are designed to be a wine, for wine, to make somebody happy, joyful. You are the flavor. You are designed to offer something unique. So the ground in which you were brought up was designed differently to give you, to make you become what you are supposed to be.
Ooh, hallelujah.
So it is not, there's no room for comparison.
That's right.
If you know what I mean, we should not say, I wish I was, I used to do like that when I was much younger. I wish I was like this. I wish I was like that. I wish I was raised in this place. I wish I was raised in that place. I wish I was raised with a bigger silver spoon or a smaller wooden spoon. We compare ourselves with ourselves. You know, keep trying to, oh, that person, that I'm going to have it too. No. Remember, he said, before I formed you, I knew you, and I appointed you, or I chose you. Now, the way we think is also different. God was teaching me all these things. He said, hey, for you to prosper, you don't have to be like that person. All you got to do is to find out what I have put on the inside of you. Because in each of my children, I have given them enough to make them very prosperous, and also to have much more than enough. And I looked at myself and I said, what? Believe me, I have more than enough. I have more than enough. You have more than enough. Not yet. It is still in a seed form. So we have to figure out what that seed is and take it, and the kind of soil that we can plant the seed in, so that it will bring about the fruit that is desired. Praise God. Praise God. So if you look at this scripture here, we have to figure out on the definiteness of purpose. What is your purpose? What is your uniqueness? What is your strength? What are you good at? And I have been asking myself that question quite lately. Eat too much. I ask myself every day, what am I good at? What am I good at? What am I good at? What am I good at apart from talking? What am I good at? What am I good at apart from talking? What am I good at apart from answering phone calls? What am I good at? Cooking. What else am I good at? And it's the same question you ask. I've been asking people around me too. What am I good at? In fact, I asked you that same question this week. Right? What am I good at? What do you think I'm good at? Because, let me say something. Sometimes, most of us have something that we don't even appreciate. You know that we don't appreciate what we have. We always see the other person's gift shine. We don't even see our arrows. You know that? Is it not true? And then we say, I wish I could develop mine to be like that person. I want to be like this person. I want to be like that person. But you have your uniqueness. And it is your uniqueness is all that you need. It is all that you need. All you need is your uniqueness. If you can water your uniqueness, so if you can zero in on your uniqueness and the singular thing that you're created for, then the next thing is to create a plan to accomplish it and to pursue it. This is what God is teaching me. What are you good at? What did I call you to do? What is that unique gift that I have given you to?